With us today is someone who's going to introduce us to the millennial and how employers need to start thinking differently about their prospects. Brendan Wallace, co-CEO of Identified.com. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
So that's a pretty big title to fill. Not the co-CEO, but the idea of introducing the millennial or a new generation of workforce to employers. What's so different this time around?
Well, I think what you're seeing is millennials are consuming information online and building their identities online in ways that generations before them never have. And they're sharing so much information, and they're so used to tools that let them cultivate and curate these very deep identities for themselves. But in the professional world, it hasn't really caught up with the social world. Because on Facebook, you can share so much about yourself, your pictures, where you're going, what you're interested in, every thought you have. You're putting it all on Facebook, and you're rushing to put it there. But your resume still represents who you are professionally. And it's such an old, static document. And really, LinkedIn is just your resume online. So when we see millennials today trying to get jobs, what they tell us is that they want a way to articulate what they have to offer companies and what they have to offer the workforce that goes far beyond the resume, but they don't have a tool to do it. So we're really trying to build what Facebook created for your social identity online, for your professional identity online.
Businesses have certainly experimented with LinkedIn. Many are on LinkedIn, many recruiters are on LinkedIn. Aside from it being the, let's call it the digital resume 1.0 or even 2.0 after the website, it's still effective. But are you seeing a difference in terms of generations in how people are adopting, say, LinkedIn versus Identified? And is there a difference also in behavior and what's done on those networks?
There definitely is. LinkedIn, the average age is 43, which is usually pretty startling to most people. It is the preeminent professional network out there. And they've managed to get a very specific demographic of people to build their identities. And those tend to be people over the age of 30 who have a lot of work experience. But young people who have built their profiles on Facebook and built their friend networks on Facebook, they look at LinkedIn and the value proposition isn't as clear, because LinkedIn's telling them, hey, recreate all this information you already have on Facebook, and then recreate these friends and connections you have that's already on Facebook. And it just doesn't resonate with them. The product feels more like a relic. Today, Unidentified, all of our growth has come through Facebook, and as a result, our age demographic, our average age is 23. So we've really attracted these millennials. And what we're seeing is that, well, they want to share so much about themselves on social networks like Twitter and Facebook, they still don't want to be recruited. So the fundamental premise of LinkedIn is still there. There's a difference between your social life and your professional life. But how do you take advantage of all these connections you've built and all this information you've built about yourself on Facebook, but still present the kind of image you want to companies? So we're trying to play that middle ground where we can actually understand what they care about in terms of representing themselves to companies, but not lose touch with what they're used to, these engaging social products where they're already spending so much time online.
Well, we've seen certain products attack this before. One was About Me. Mm-hmm. However, Identified is much more sophisticated and elaborate. But is there a recognition that this is even a need among the millennial, that they have to package themselves in a way that Facebook, About Me, Twitter, even their blog or YouTube channel isn't doing today?
The reason About Me kind of took off so quickly was it gave people a way to articulate what made them different, right? You could actually put this kind of short snippet about yourself, what's really captured who you are, and put this really interesting picture, and it wasn't as constraining as that environment on Facebook or on LinkedIn. And people wanted that because they're like, really, I come down to a few key things I want people to understand about me. The problem is, though, professional hasn't really evolved. The resume is, like I said, it's the basic unit of denomination in recruiting. And LinkedIn is more or less synonymous with the resume. And for young people, they're viewing themselves more like free agents in the workforce, right? So they're moving from jobs more frequently than people in generations before. And they're using each opportunity almost as a stepping stone to new opportunities. So it's almost like they're curating their resume, right? And they're constantly doing it, and they're positioning themselves for the future. But how can they articulate that? How can they actually build a profile that articulates how these different experiences they've collected actually make them unique and perfectly suited for a job? Because in my parents' generation, you saw the the notion or the ideal of the company man or the company woman that would spend their entire lives at a company and progress through the ranks. Young people really care about fit. They want to find a position, and they want to find a company where the culture, the opportunity, the responsibilities perfectly jives with what they want to do. And it cuts two ways, because companies want to find people that are best suited for their culture. But the resume doesn't do it. The resume just doesn't have enough information. So I think what we're seeing is these tools like About Me and some of these new products, they're trying to let people curate these deeper identities professionally. They're giving these millennials a chance to really say, here's what makes me different. Here's why you should hire me and not everyone else that on paper looks just like me.
I want to talk about behavior for a moment, because some of the things you just brought up are fascinating. I hosted a debate recently between, we'll just say, a boomer and a millennial. The millennial is a successful entrepreneur, and the boomer is a successful investor. And the advice that the boomer was giving the millennial was that because of his experienced past, and experience is a kind way of putting the fact that he had multiple jobs on his resume, that it would be frowned upon because of hopping around over and over again.
The boomer was saying this to the millennial.
To the millennial.
Got it.
Millennial's counter was exactly to your point. But in this case, where you have older generations responsible for hiring younger generations within larger organizations, is that disconnect apparent? And what can prospects or employees or millennials do to ensure that they convey that they are interested in true opportunities, and how can, let's just say, recruiters recognize that there's a difference in behavior and it's a good thing?
So I think there's two things I would say. One is, I feel like every generation says that about the generation after it, right? They're always saying they move around too much, they're moving too quickly, and I think that is true. And I think there definitely is the impression amongst these boomers who are ultimately making the hiring decisions in companies that millennials are moving too quickly. They're sharing too much, they're doing too many things, there's just too much that they're doing. And that's represented a lot online. But what I think is important is that change oftentimes leads to better fit. So take me, for example. I graduated school, and I graduated from Princeton. And like every kid out of Princeton, all the big investment banks and consulting firms came down and put on the parade on campus, and I went to those information sessions, and next thing I knew, I was an investment banker. And I was like, what is this? You know, I actually have to now do spreadsheets, and I don't really know what to do. I kind of followed this herding behavior. And then after 2 years at Goldman Sachs, I went to Blackstone, and I was in private equity, and I did that for 2 years. And I started to realize, you know what? I've followed this path of what's predicted and what's expected for me, but it wasn't what I wanted to do. I wanted to run a company. I wanted to make a difference. I wanted to do things where I was leading people. And the path I was in wasn't giving me that opportunity. So it's almost like after 4 years of working so hard, that finally dawned on me. And I only realized it by learning these things I didn't like to do. So in many ways, that kind of job-hopping behavior, well, it's not a great thing. It leads to a better self-recognition of what am I good at? What am I going to do with the rest of my life? You're so young, you're in your 20s. You want to make those decisions early on. You don't want to be 40, 45 and be like, oh my gosh, I've been doing this for 25 years and this isn't what I'm called to do. And I think younger people are figuring that out faster because they're changing jobs so much. What the challenge they often tell us is that they don't have enough information to make those choices and make those decisions, because you have so much information online. I mean, you can decide what kind of socks to buy based on reviews online, but what kind of job you take, you almost have no information about. And you want to know, hey, how does that job position me for my next job? What's the probability I get promoted? Or what's the probability I stay in this industry? Or what's the probability that puts me into business school or graduate school? Nothing really tells you that. So what we're trying to build is a tool that gives these young millennial users a chance to make those decisions equipped with the information they need to best position themselves. So even if they're job hopping frequently, it's still leading in a trajectory that's toward their ultimate goal.
Do you think that there's an expectation gap between millennials and hiring managers today, in the sense that hiring managers are looking for long-term players? And I read data earlier in the year that said most millennials on Facebook list themselves as entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. And when you dive deeper into it, they're really not at this point looking for long-term careers. They're looking to learn and find better matches. What would you say to the hiring manager to convince them that indeed finding the right person, even if it's for the short term, is a good thing for that organization?
Mm-hmm. I would say two things. I'd say one, you can find the right person who's going to stay at your organization, but it can't be a static job. It has to be an evolving opportunity. So you give someone a set of responsibilities, and they have those responsibilities early on, but they want to know what they're going to do in 2 years, and what they're going to do 2 years after that, and how that leads to this progression, this arc of their career. And the best jobs and the best companies seem to do that really well. They give you a chance to grow in that particular company. The second thing is, I think companies need to start viewing themselves as much as these long-term employers as stepping stones. And while that's probably not what hiring managers like to hear, I think there's a lot they can gain from doing that, because certain job opportunities position you to do something else right afterwards in ways that were never before possible. So if you articulate to young millennials who are just coming out of school or early in their careers, hey, if you pursue this opportunity, I'm going to train you. I'm going to give you a network. I'm going to give you a skill set that you can then apply to something else. That's a very transferable knowledge set, and you can accumulate it at very particular companies. And we all know companies here in the Valley that do this very well. Zynga and Facebook, they groom engineers and they groom product managers and say game design, and they come out and go to other companies equipped with that knowledge. It's a great stepping stone.
Or they start their own companies.
Or they start their own companies, exactly. But it's a great, very transferable knowledge set. And I think companies can actually market that message very well to young users who are thinking about that all the time when they're making these important career decisions.
One of the things you talked about is the idea that an organization has to look at its culture of how it thinks about relationships with employees. I think that for progressive companies, certainly here in Silicon Valley, we've seen a lot of that thinking for quite some time, especially here since competition for talent is so fierce. But for organizations around the country, around the world, where they're just used to doing things a certain way for a long period of time, how are they going to see the need to change for what isn't necessarily a pain point for them today? Maybe it's a pain in the fact that they can't find the right person or the right person leaves. What's it going to take for them to start to recognize that maybe they do need to change their processes internally?
I think it's an aging workforce. I think that companies that don't adapt and don't accommodate this younger generation of worker, these millennials that are coming into the workforce and care so much about culture and care so much about their development of their career, if you're a static organization, you're going to attract static people and people that do not want that. And so I think companies will start to see that don't adapt, that their workforces are getting older, they're losing some of their best talent to the companies that are evolving and being more dynamic in how they treat career management. So it's tough to say, you know, kind of it's corporate Darwinism, but I think to some extent it is. The best companies that evolve and suit that young generation will be the companies that will win that war for talent and get the best people, even if it's just for a few years, to work for them. And you can see companies here in Silicon Valley, company can get made and sold or IPO'd in like 3 or 4 years. So in some cases, that's all you need, right? You just need to attract the best talent for a very finite period of time. But you're right, it is very hard, and it is a real break with how some companies viewed managing their talent and managing their culture over time.
Absolutely. So in parting, what advice would you give to millennials using your service and just in general, as well as organizations? How can they best leverage your service, and how can they best start thinking about millennials in the long term?
I think it all comes down to doing what you love. And I think that's very hard for people to find early on in their career. You graduate school and you're expected to get a job, but you're so young in your life and your views haven't really been formed with or crystallized with any real kind of life experience, that it's very hard to know, this is what I love, this is what I'm good at. And I think the way you learn that is by trying different things and learning from them. So I would actually encourage people to think about how you're planning your career to ultimately land on as fast as possible what you love and what you're good at. Because as everyone who's ever succeeded in business tells you, doing what you love is the best way to be successful. On the other side of the equation, on the side of companies, I think companies need to figure out, how are we going to attract the kind of people that are going to love doing what they do here? And who are those people? So it's kind of a self-recognition on both sides, that finding people that want to do what they love, they're going to be the most successful. And companies that find those people who are going to love what they're doing at that company, those are going to be the most successful companies. But the key is kind of connecting that information asymmetry, which right now is this evolution of the workforce, right? There's all this new information out there. How can you actually empower both sides to find out who those people are and what those opportunities are?
Do what you love, and hire those who love what they do. And the only last words I could think of for organizations out there is adapt or die. Brendan, thank you so much for
being on the show. Thanks so much.